And it's about automation of browser interaction. And Playwright is what cost me most of my Christmas break. Once in a while, I run into a tool, a technology that's both valuable, powerful, as well as fun. And in this case, it was a lot of fun, and I kept thinking of things that perhaps could be automated using Playwright, and then I tried them out, and then it turned out that they could, or they were a bit hard, but in the end they could, and I kept adding more things, so this took away a lot of spare time, and today basically is about sharing my experiences over that Christmas period. On this slide, you see the bit.ly link for the workshop resources, and also it's where you will find the slides that I'm showing you. You don't have to take notes, you don't have to take screenshots, you're of course free to do so, but all the resources are available. Before I started the recording, before I get started on Playwright itself, maybe it's a good thing to tell you a little bit about myself. And I'm watching the presentation on a second screen, but I don't see the next slide. So, there it goes. It's a bit slow. My name is Lucas Jellema. Some of you know me. There are probably some of you who do not. I work for Amis, part of Conclusion, in the Netherlands. I've worked there for quite a number of years, 18 and a bit. I'm a solution architect, but I'm also a programmer, or maybe a tinkerer. And some of the technologies that I play with are Node.js and web development technologies, HTML5, JavaScript in the browser, not so much CSS, but in order to do browser automation, you better know a little bit about CSS as well, as you will see over the course of the presentation. So in the announcement for this session, I claimed in the TLDR, if you are a programmer and you do any work at all with web browsers, and of course you do because everyone does, this session has the potential to change your professional life. Big words, and maybe they don't apply to you in full, but I'm sure that you will take some use from this session, if only an understanding of what could be done. And to be honest, I was quite amazed about all the things that we can automate using Playwright and how easily it can be done. So if you are engaged in doing web development, in doing integration, backend integration, in doing data engineering, in doing DevOps automation, test engineering, this session has something for you. Even if you currently are not using a browser to perform certain tasks, it might very well be the case that by using Playwright and a browser, your task may become easier, or things that you thought weren't possible turn out to be possible after all. If you're a designer or a solution architect, you should be aware as well when you are creating your technical design or thinking up your solution, even if you are not going to be coding yourself. In the end, Playwright means coding, but understanding what Playwright can do, of course, does not require you to code. So in summary, what is this session about? What can Playwright do for you? Playwright gives you access to a browser from within your own program, your own Node program, and Node is the programming language I will be using today, but the same applies to Python and Go and Java and C#, although all of those are still in preview. Node.js is the most easy way into Playwright. So in your program, you get access to a browser. The browser is embedded in your program, and you have full control over what's happening inside the browser. So you can load any application, any website, anything that runs in a browser, you can load it into your embedded browser, and then still have full access to it from your program. That basically means that anything that as a human user you could do through your browser interface, you can do the same thing from your program. So any task that as a user you wouldn't like to do because you it's repetitive, or it requires use accuracy, or it takes a very long time, if you can turn it into a recipe, into something that you can program, then you can execute it through Playwright in that same web application user interface. You can do even more, because in Playwright, you can also access the DOM model and all the JavaScript in this website or this web application. So instead of only being able to do the things that a normal user can do through the UI, you can do much more that can be useful for making things even more efficient, more productive. It can also help you do meta testing, because you do not only have to run a test through the UI aspects of your application, but you can also do a direct test of all the JavaScript that's part of the client side of the web application. I could say so much more, but it's probably better to just show you. So this agenda, why, what, how, and then do it yourself. The why, I'm not going to explain that in detail. That's going to have to explain itself. The fact that you are attending this session is probably part of the answer. You're here, so you see the value. The first real part of this session is about the what. What can you do? What can Playwright do for you? There will not be any code in this section. And you should get a pretty good feel of how you can make use of Playwright to go to take the extra step with automating tasks in your organization, in your processes, etc. And then after that, we'll be talking about the how. And in the how part, I will talk about the technology, about the integration, and also I will be showing code. It will be my code at that stage. After that section, we come to the do-it-yourself part. And that's where you will go and do the workshop for which the resources are available at the bit.ly link that you see in the lower left-hand corner. Of course, you can decide to only stick around for the what part or to listen to the how part, but don't actually go and do it yourself. That's all up to you. So, time for a first demonstration. I guess most of you have to fill in some form of timesheet. And the picture shows it on paper, but I guess most of you do not do it on paper. You probably will have an application to do it with. That doesn't necessarily mean it's a very easy thing to do. And I would like to give you a very brief demonstration of the timesheet application that I have to use and that I use on a daily basis to record my hours. And at this stage, I should stop sharing the PowerPoint and start sharing the desktop. I should go into... So now I'm showing you how to log in to my application. Username, organizations, sign in. And now the two-factor authentication. So at this point, I'm handing over to my mobile phone and approving the login. It's continuing. Want to stay signed in. I have to select Uren. Now a second application is started, which gives me a menu with exactly one option. So I still need to select that option. And now all the projects for which I can record hours are retrieved. And then before I can actually start writing hours, I have to expand each of these rows. And you can see that I can write hours for quite a few projects and I need to expand all of them. This is not very convenient. This is not the way I would like to interact with this particular web application. And what I created using Playwright is what I call a deep link bookmark. So here is my Windows desktop. Here's a shortcut. I double click on the shortcut, and now Playwright, or the program I created using Playwright, will open the web application. All of this is done without my intervention, except for the multi-factor authentication that stays the same. And the full login, the navigation, the menu selection, and the expansion of all the hours in the timesheet is all done fully automatically. It's a little bit faster than when I do it by hand, but of course the main gain here is the comfort. It doesn't take my time. I can go away and get some coffee or make a bathroom stop. All of this is done through Playwright. And now here I am ready to go. So it's the same standard web application, but the access path into the application has been automated using Playwright, just as an example. So now I return to the person. On the left side, you see the manual path, all these steps. And the essence here is that all these steps are the same. Every day, every time I go into the application, these steps are the same. And because they are the same all the time, they can be automated. And that's what I did. So here is just one example of what Playwright allows me to do to automate a certain sequence of tasks with a browser application. What I didn't show here is how I can also extend this browser application. It's a SaaS application, it's not my application, but using Playwright, I can still extend it by adding additional functionality into it. Shortcuts, for example, to even further automate tasks while working with this application. So what's taking place under the hood? Well, this shortcut fires up a Node.js application. This Node.js application uses the Playwright library, and using that Playwright library, it runs a browser. In this case, it's the Chromium browser. Playwright also supports WebKit and Firefox. This browser then loads the web application, and through Playwright, all the actions that I normally would have to do manually are now done automatically. And if you take a look at the underlying Node.js program, it says things like click button, click link, scroll page, and things like that. Different example. Fairly familiar example when it comes to browser automation, frequently called data scraping or screen scraping. Many websites, many web applications, expose data. Sometimes that same data is exposed through APIs, open data APIs, for example, but sometimes they don't, or we do not have access to the APIs. Again, SaaS applications may contain a lot of information that's useful to us. It might even be our own data, but if the SaaS application doesn't provide a proper API, like for example, Oracle eBusiness Suite for many years didn't provide a proper API, then I can create my own API, or at least I can scrape data using browser automation tools such as Playwright. So I will show you an example. IMDb, the international movie database, it doesn't have an API, or at least not to my knowledge. However, it does contain a lot of data that I find interesting. So what I could do is use Playwright to load the IMDb website into my embedded browser, then start manipulating this website in the same way I was just manipulating my timesheet application. and then interact with the content of the browser that's embedded in my program. And from that content, what we call the document object model, the DOM in the browser, I can retrieve elements, and these elements contain the information I'm interested in. So in this case, by following this approach, I can derive the JSON document that you see on the left-hand side from the DOM elements that are loaded into my embedded browser on the right side. And I can show you that too in a quick demo. And of course, all these demos are available to you as well. IMDb, I forget what the name of the program is, movie. There we go. Currently, there are no images. So I run the program. A Node.js program is started, just as it was for the timesheet application. And in this case, I was running the program in headless mode, which means that we didn't see a browser opening, and we don't really care about the browser. We only care about the data. So here you see the data in JSON format. So this data was just retrieved from IMDb based on a list of three movies that is that's part of the code. So if you take a look at the code, I wasn't going to show code in this session. Well, this is the only code that I will show. It also downloaded the posters for these three movies. The message here, using Node.js, Playwright, I can bring any web application, any website into my embedded browser, and then pick the data that's loaded into that website or web application. I can pick the data from the website and then process it in my Node.js application. I can write it to a JSON document. I can send it to a database or do anything I like. Well, a fairly small step beyond scraping the data is turning an existing user interface into an API. So provide a live application programmatic interface that currently does not exist by making use of a web UI. Our service bus, our programmatic consumers of data can't work with user interfaces. People can work with user interfaces. But in order to provide a programmatic interface, an API, we can make use of an existing user interface. And I think at this stage, you won't be too surprised to learn that we can do so using, again, Node.js to intercept HTTP requests and then process the HTTP requests that the API receives using Playwright, the embedded browser, and a web application that's loaded into the embedded browser. An example of this would be Google Translate. You are probably familiar with the Google Translate user interface. I don't believe there is an official API for Google Translate. Doesn't really matter for this example. What I want to create is my own API that performs a translation. I don't have a translation engine, but I do have access to the user interface of Google Translate. So in this case, I can publish such an API, make use of Node.js, Playwright, and load Google Translate. So again, let me briefly show you the demo. Translate.js. Again, you will see nothing because it's in headless mode. But what I get is a translation result. And let's very briefly look at what was the sentence that we now get translated. This, by the way, is not yet an API, of course. So here is the instruction to translate. It's about shopping. Well, let's not take a look at this. Let's run the API. So at this stage, I'm running a Node.js application that listens to HTTP requests. It listens at localhost port 3000, but of course this could be published as a web application externally as well, a REST API. And now I have to very briefly look at the structure of the URL. That's somewhat unfortunate. I don't remember. An example. So here in my browser, I send a request to localhost port 3000, a request that's handled by my Node.js application that leverages Google Translate live. So in this case, I'm sending in "Hello, good green planet," and I'm asking for a translation from English to Spanish. Of course, I could ask for translation from English to French. It'll take a few seconds. And there's my translation. Behind the scenes, under the hood, in headless mode, Google Translate UI was loaded into my embedded browser in my Node.js application. The fields were entered, and the result was scraped or retrieved from the browser UI, and returned from the Node.js application as an HTTP response. So from a user's perspective, this looks like an API, but it's still using the user interface that Google publishes. Of course, there are some ethical considerations here, and I will return to that in a moment. Okay. If there are any questions, while presenting, I can't see the chat. So if there is a question, please let me know, and I will be happy to respond. All right. So on this slide, you basically see what I was just demonstrating. In this case, I'm using Postman to send the API request. And you can see here on the lower right-hand side what it looks like internally, although it doesn't really look like this because we're running in headless mode and no actual browser UI is published. You can do the same thing with WhatsApp. WhatsApp was famous for not publishing an API and many people wanting to have an API. Now there is this business license that you can get with WhatsApp, but it's not so simple to use, and I'm not exactly sure how it works, but it turns out to be not too hard to create our own API on top of WhatsApp by using the web UI of WhatsApp. It's the same story as before. I publish an API. I can send an HTTP request to this REST API to send a specific message to a specific contact. The API is implemented by Node.js using Playwright. It loads the web UI for WhatsApp, and it will simply interact with the DOM elements in this web UI. For the interest of time, I'm not going to demonstrate this. I did write an article about it, so all the information that you might be interested in is available. So I've been using Playwright already quite a bit, but I haven't really told you what it is. So now I think it's time for an introduction of Playwright itself. It deserves to have the stage, of course. So Playwright is, on the one hand, relatively new. Its first release was only early last year, so it's about a year old, and it wasn't even the 1.0 release that came in May. There were more than a dozen releases last year, but it isn't really all that new because it's a technology built by a team at Microsoft that used to be a team at Google and that used to create Puppeteer. If you know a library called Puppeteer, you probably had the impression that Playwright is something very similar, and it is. It's everything Puppeteer is, and more, or at least it will be. For starters, Puppeteer only supports Chromium browser, and Playwright, as I mentioned before, also supports Firefox and WebKit. And it feels like there's a huge momentum for Playwright, much larger even than Puppeteer had. Microsoft is also really making a big deal out of this. So the main use case for Playwright is to enable reliable end-to-end testing from modern web application, or any web application, really. And you're probably familiar with tools like Selenium or Cypress that use the WebDriver. This is an alternative for those tools. And I have worked with Selenium in the past, but it has been a long time. I didn't really like it. I like Playwright much better, but perhaps that isn't fair regarding Selenium, because I haven't been using it anytime recent. If you are happy with those tools, you can probably make your own comparison. It feels, from all the information I've been seeing, that Playwright is not just the new kid on the block, but also the very popular kid on the block with a lot of momentum in terms of its evolution. And I like it, but I'm not claiming it's better in all cases than the other tools, because I simply don't know. It's open source, and you can find all the sources on GitHub. Okay. In general, you probably know that in a browser, you make HTTP requests, and as a result to these requests, content is loaded to your browser and interpreted by your browser. And your browser knows how to display HTML, how to apply CSS on top of the HTML, how to execute JavaScript, how to display images, how to display scalable vector graphics, SVG. And that's basically how websites and web applications work. All these resources are loaded into your browser, and your browser starts to process all of that. And your browser runs in a sandbox, because otherwise all this code that you download from third-party sites and third-party applications could wreak havoc on your local environment. In your browser, as a developer, you know there is this DOM, this document object model, of all the elements that are displayed or that are not displayed but are still part of your web page. And there are things like iframes. There are also things like web workers. There's the whole JavaScript memory context. There's also local storage that persists across browser instances. And there are cookies that also tend to be quite persistent, as you probably know. And what can we load in our browser? Well, third-party SaaS applications, BI dashboards, cloud portals and consoles, custom applications, static websites, public websites, our intranet, a web UI on top of an FTP server, and anything else that you can think of. And all of this is ripe for manipulation, interaction, inspection from Playwright. And as I mentioned before, this is done by embedding the browser in a custom application. So this browser, in this case, no longer is a standalone browser that you start just from a shortcut on your desktop. No, it's a browser that's initiated programmatically from your Node application. And it's very easy, by the way, to run a browser from a Node application. And if you run it in head full mode, it looks just like a browser, like the browser I just started for the timesheet application. It's just a browser with a slightly different colored logo. It's the blue logo for Chromium instead of the differently colored logo for the Chrome browser. So there's a very slight distinction. Anything our browser would normally do, it can still do. And most of the things it can normally do, it can now also do, triggered by my code or your code in the custom Node.js application. So the browser will make the same requests it always made in order to run a certain web application, but it can also make additional requests if we make it make those requests. And we can even mock requests, so prevent the actual HTTP request from being sent out when we want to test our certain web application in isolation. More about that later on. What we can also do through Playwright from our own code is read anything that's in this browser context. Read the contents of DOM elements. We can fill in files, click buttons, trigger any event, and execute JavaScript and even add JavaScript to web application or override existing JavaScript. You can do so many fun things. We don't have time for all the fun things. And our application becomes a robot or even a series of robots that work with the browser just like humans could, but then do it faster for longer times with fewer errors. That's probably the mental picture that fits best. So the web application sort of gets sucked in to our embedded browser, the one that we programmatically control, and it will still interact with its backend where it retrieves resources and it can make API calls. Well, these can still be made. They can be inspected and monitored, and they can also be intercepted and thereby mocked. As I mentioned, Playwright is available for JavaScript, for Node.js, but it's also available for Python, C Sharp, Go, and Java. Those four implementations are still in preview, are relatively new. The homepage is playwright.dev, and Microsoft also makes available a Docker container that contains a fully installed Playwright environment that you can add your own, for example, Node application into that uses Playwright, and that in turn can be a perfect foundation for serverless functions that you can run in a cloud environment, for example, for running tests, but also for running health checks on your web application, on your public web application or a private web application, to continuously check whether they're still available, whether the main functional flows are still functioning, and whether the performance is all right. So some of the eye-catching features in Playwright, and I mentioned a few and I demonstrated a few already. You can run it both in headless mode and head full mode. Do you want to see the browser or not? If you don't want to see the browser, you can run in a programmatic environment like a headless Linux environment. It allows bidirectional JavaScript interaction. You can invoke JavaScript from your Node application, JavaScript running inside the browser, and also in the other direction. And we will see examples of this. It's kind of hard to get your head around. It took me a while. It supports integration with debugging tools. It gives you full control over pop-ups, over multiple iframes in your page, and even over multiple pages. So you can open multiple browser tabs or even multiple browser windows and control them all from the same application. Playwright has support for downloading files and uploading files. And of course, that can be part of the application that you want to test, or it can be part of the application that you want to automate. You can quite easily get images and write them to a file. You can create screenshots of whatever's currently showing in your browser viewport, or you can generate a PDF of the entire contents of the web page, including the parts that are currently not visible, but you need to scroll the page for. You can record a Playwright session as a video, which can be very helpful to find out where things went wrong, or just to create a nice video. You have access to the Web Performance API, so you can do quite advanced performance analysis of the web application that you're automating. It has support for social login. You can read and set cookies, which can be very helpful in order to initialize a session that you want to use for testing or for automating tasks. And not just cookies, but also local storage. There's also the option to interact with web workers for background tasks. As I mentioned, manipulating network requests. There are tools to record the user actions on a website and turn that recording into a Playwright script, I wasn't overly happy with the results. The way the fields and buttons are identified in the recording is not as intuitive as you would like them to be. And you will find out if you try for yourself. Playwright comes with a test runner, but it also supports integration with other test runners in order to make Playwright scripts part of an automated test process. So I believe you can do many things using Playwright. And maybe at this stage, I should take a brief look if there are any questions. So in the chat. Are there any questions I should answer? Can somebody tell me? I hear no one, so I'll just continue. Many opportunities open up, many things that we can do using Playwright. And these, some of them are extremely obvious and others are just figments of my imagination. So bear with me. The deep link bookmarks, as I just demonstrated, and that's for me personally a productivity booster. I can very easily open up the Azure cloud portal and go to a specific point in the portal where I need to check something, and I need to do it every day or every hour. So that's an option. Of course, the automation of UI tests, the main use case for Playwright. That's just the obvious testing. I run a browser, I load a web application, I try to enter information in certain fields, push a button and wait for the result. But also unit testing of all the JavaScript that's part of the client side of the application. I can perform fairly advanced load testing. And there's also visual regression testing. So that basically means is in my test, I make a screenshot of the application and I compare it with the screenshot that I took yesterday or at some at the release date of the application. And then using one of these libraries, I can compare today's screenshot with the screenshot from so many days back and learn whether there is a meaningful difference between the screenshots. So here's a combination between what Playwright can do and what these libraries can do to help me understand whether something seems to have gone wrong with my user interface. Then there's tactical integration. So instead of creating a complex service bus based integration scenario, if there's only a little bit of data that I need, or I need it very quickly, then I could use browser automation using Playwright to do data retrieval, screen scraping, as I just demonstrated with IMDb. And in a very similar sense, you could also do easy data entry. I could enter all my timesheet entries from a CSV file, for example. I don't have to actually go into the web application myself. I could easily automate that. So where a formal API is too much work, tactical integration using a tool such as Playwright could be a good alternative. I mentioned the health check, automatic monitoring of user interfaces, their availability, their functionality, and their performance. Automated reporting, and I will show you an example of this in a moment, but suppose you have to each day or each hour go to a number of websites, look at charts, collect some images, read some text, and then put it all together into a report. Could be an email, could be a PDF document, could be a PowerPoint presentation. That's something that you can easily automate using Playwright, as I will show you. You can customize web applications. So if you load a web application using Playwright in your Node.js application, you can extend that web application. And again, I will show you examples of this a little bit later on. You can take an existing user interface and turn it into an API. Of course, this is very similar to tactical integration. And you can provide automated demonstrations or step-by-step instructions of the use of web applications or websites, where you can have a very nice combination between the steps that are automated using Playwright and still the availability of the live application, because you're just running in a regular browser. I will show you this as well in a moment. And then there's the robotic process automation, for which there are very expensive tools, very complex tools, very highly touted tools. Playwright also allows you to do RPA, and it's very easy, as you have seen from my DeepLink bookmark, to create a workflow that has part of the steps automated by a robot and a part performed by a human, like the multi-factor authentication, where I still need to do something on my phone, but then the rest of the steps are automated. And because with Playwright we can open multiple browser tabs and access the contents of all of these browser tabs from the same program, it's fairly easy to take information from one site and enter it into another site, for example. What you could also do is prototype an application. You can take an application of your own, or even a web application from a third party, run it in an embedded browser in a Playwright program, and then start changing it. Because through Playwright, we can manipulate the DOM, we can manipulate the CSS, we can manipulate the JavaScript, we can try out things in this application, and that might be easier and changing the source code, especially if we don't have the source code. I know this is far-fetched, but I'm just trying to trigger your own imagination and think of all the things that become possible. I mentioned before the ethics. Not all of the things that you can do, especially with third-party applications, are things that you should do. Scraping data, if you do it with the same frequency, for example, as you would do it manually, I think that's okay. That's my own personal my own personal ethic. But if you start scraping data at a far higher frequency than you would ever do as a human user, then you're probably not doing things in the right way, and you stand the risk, of course, of being blocked altogether, as has happened several times to me, even as I was trying to be ethical. You should also realize that any integration or any API that's implemented on top of a user interface is brittle. It stands the risk of being undermined because of changes to the underlying user interface. We humans are fairly flexible when it comes to changes in a user interface. We may not like the changes, but we can probably still work with the user interface. But our programmatic implementation is probably not as flexible. So this is just something that you need to be aware of. It doesn't need to be a big problem. And most changes probably do not change the fundamental functionality of a user interface. So we can probably fairly easily remedy the problem, but still be aware of the brittleness and be aware of the ethics. Okay, instead of explaining this one, it's probably better to just demonstrate it to you. Step by step. Okay. Again, I'm running an application. It's using Playwright. It loads Wikipedia. It navigates to the homepage of Wikipedia, and then it injects two things. It injects this toolbar, and this toolbar has a number of options. So, for example, snapshot. If I press snapshot, and I can do right now, a snapshot is taken of this page. First, the toolbar is hidden, and then a snapshot is taken. A PNG has been written to my local file system, step by step, snapshots. It has been written somewhere else. It has been written. I can also save all the images in the page, but that's not what I want to demonstrate. This call out has been injected as well. And now I can run a number of scenarios. Let's, for example, play the current scenario, the tour of the Netherlands. There we go. And now Playwright is taking over. It's performing a number of actions, a search for the Netherlands, navigating to the page about the Netherlands, and it's showing a new text. Coming up, a little history. Let's play a little history. And now the next step in the scenario is executed. The page is scrolled, some additional text is shown, and the next section would be sports. Let's play the next section. There we go. And even some text is highlighted. This is not highlighted on Wikipedia. This is highlighted by my Playwright program. And finally, let's play culture. Again, page is scrolled, information is shown. This element is hovered. That's also done programmatically. A link is opened in a second tab. After 5 seconds, the tab is closed again, and here we are. I can also switch the scenario for a tour of France and for an excursion in Great Britain, etc., etc. It's of course not about these scenarios, but it's about what I've just demonstrated. I can take a regular web page, web application, inject objects into it, and take the user on a tour. A tour that partly consists of things that have been automated, but it also still allows me to do regular interaction with the web page. It's just the same web page as always. It just has been extended. I can make use of the extensions, but I don't have to. I can also go to Germany, even if there is no excursion about Germany. But I can also, of course, go to my excursion about the United Kingdom, and there we go. And then I was talking about generating a report. And maybe here I should first show you what I'm going to do, and then I will demonstrate. My objective here is to create a daily COVID-19 report in PowerPoint format. So I would like to go to a number of websites and gather data about the state of COVID-19 in various countries, and then compile all that information into a single PowerPoint report. Maybe at this point I should run the demo. No, it's the PowerPoint itself. Generate report. Enter. And now it will open a browser. And in the browser, it will go to a site which provides information about the COVID-19 status for the whole world. It takes a screenshot. It will go to Japan. It takes a screenshot. It goes to a different site, which also has information about Japan, and then a third site, which has information about Japan. And it takes all the information from all these sites and locally on the file system, create the image files. And then when it has visited all the sites, it will go ahead and generate the PowerPoint file. UK, it will do the Netherlands, and then it's done. Now, in this case, it's doing everything sequentially. I was still working on a way to get it done in parallel, because there's really no reason why I couldn't open multiple browser tabs and access the different sites in these parallel browser tabs. So let me quickly show you the PowerPoint report that was just generated. So this is the first page with information about the whole world, and then there's information about Japan. So here you see information taken from four different sites, same layout for the US, for the UK, and for the Netherlands. And what I did here was making use of an NPM module called pptx gen.js. So with Playwright, I collect all the information from all the sites, and I then programmatically generate the PowerPoint document using this module. I also use a module to take an SVG from a website and turn it into a PNG. And I could also use, but I didn't, use the module GIMP for further image manipulation. And I generate the PowerPoint, and this more or less what a PowerPoint document looks like. Here are some additional countries, but it takes longer, so I took them out of the presentation. All right, well, that concludes section two, actually the first section of the presentation, but the one listed here under two, what it can do. So I hope now you have a general idea about what Playwright can do and what that in turn allows us to implement in terms of automation through browsers. I'm not claiming this list is complete. I added new things even this week after a month and a half of working with Playwright. So I'm sure there are many more things that we could add. But hopefully now you have enough idea to be somewhat stimulated, if you like. I think now is probably a good time to do a short break. I was thinking about, and I have actually prepared a timer. I think we would take a break of 10 minutes. So there we go. I suggest you get something to drink, make a bathroom stop. If you want to ask questions, please go ahead. I will stay around. And when the timer hits zero, we will continue with the next part, which is how. How can we use Playwright to actually get things done? What does the code look like? And how do you make use of Playwright? So hopefully you will stick around and be back in a few minutes.
Hi, Lucas. This is Mark. Hey. I have a question. So what is the learning curve? What is, in your experience, the learning curve from this tool compared to alternatives? And I also mean the alternatives using a user interface that are not programmatic, or how do you call it?
I find it hard to answer that question because of my own experience with alternatives is fairly limited, and even my experience with Playwright is fairly limited. I find it, once you understand a few basic concepts with Playwright, I find it fairly easy to get going and implement fairly advanced scenarios. The testability of an application, or the automatability of an application, varies. It depends, for example, on the use of identifiers, the use of CSS class identifiers. If these are generated and can change, then it becomes much harder to automate. But of course, in your own application, it's something you control yourself. In order to create a Playwright scenario, you do need to be a programmer. You do not need to be an exceptional programmer, but you do need to be able to program in JavaScript. And you also need to understand the structure of a web page. You need to understand the DOM. You need to understand a little bit about CSS in order to select the right elements from the DOM. I suppose that applies probably to most alternatives, certainly Selenium and Cypress. As I said, there is a recorder, but I don't like it too much because of the scripts that the recorder creates are not very human readable. They work, but they don't necessarily work in the right way because they don't select elements based on intelligence, but just on, for example, take the sixth row in a certain table. And maybe we are interested in that row because the row is about a certain customer. And that happens to be the sixth today, but it might be the fourth or the third tomorrow. So that's a selection pattern that works, but that is extremely brittle. So the recorder is not something that I'm convinced by.
No, well, I see that with most of these alternatives also. It's not easy sometimes to get exactly the data you want. And also, yeah, you need to transform the data to get it in the formatting you want, like with dates or time. When you scrape these, you have to format them to a correct data type. But this is a nice alternative. Thank you very much for this presentation.
You're welcome. And to be honest, I like it so much that I really wanted to share my experiences. And I'm glad that so many people are interested.
Yeah, but I do think these are just for more like hobby, problematic things, you know, because if you really want to connect to another service business-wise, well, you run into these things you said, because the DOM can change, of course, you have a limited amount of data you can pull in, of course, on a daily basis. So then an API with a fixed data model and a contract you have with this provider will be better.
Yeah, but as I said, these aren't always available. As a simple example, I was talking the other day to my brother. He works for a Swiss company, and they have large customers. And with these large customers, they set up custom integrations, APIs, web services, whatever. But they also have many smaller customers. And for these customers, they cannot afford to create custom integrations. But these customers tend to require some form of automated interaction all the same. And my brother tells me that they are using RPA, and I think they're doing it using UiPath, but I'm not entirely sure. They are using RPA to take information from their own systems, for which they do have APIs, and enter the information through the website of these smaller customers. And the idea is that this integration, tactical integration, I called it before, is fairly easy to set up. If it fails, it's not a big problem. And it can still be fixed, and you always have the workaround of doing it manually. It's not a lot of data that's exchanged, but if it can be automated at all, it's huge savings. So you know it can be done in a better way with a proper integration, but if that can be done in terms of time or in terms of budget or even technical expertise, then this could be a nice alternative. And I'm not a big fan of RPA, but when he explained this situation, I can certainly see that, well, this is also a use case.
Yeah, that's a nice
I also believe that for data engineers that need to collect data from many different data sources, this could be a nice way of getting data from a certain source that, again, doesn't have an API. Get the information once, or maybe even get information every day, every hour. It shouldn't then be too much information, as we were just discussing, but still it could be useful. My sister-in-law had a different story to tell. She works at a publishing company, and they acquired a different publisher company, and they publish a number of magazines. And my sister-in-law was tasked with getting all the electronic files for all these magazines for a decade back, to get all these files from an FTP server over into a different electronic repository. And she ended up hiring a temp worker to do it all manually through a browser. And I think it took the temp worker 2 or 3 days. And I'm quite sure that I could have written a Playwright-based script for automating the task, in probably an hour and a half. I only found out after the fact, but this is just an example of, well, she couldn't have programmed it. I could have. If I run into these tasks, it's something that, well, that I can do, and now hopefully all of you can do, or at least can consider to do.
Yeah, funny, I did a SharePoint intranet web page migration by web scraping all the articles and then uploading it into a new web page because we couldn't have a migration agreed with the provider. So that was also a nice project.
Yeah, and I think the situation where an API for whatever reason or an export function for whatever reason isn't available or isn't as convenient to use or as quickly available as you would like it to have, these are situations where being able to automate a task at least gives you an alternative.
Yep.
Okay, well, I hope you're all refreshed. Counting down. I'm not even sure what happens when it hits zero. It just hits zero. Ah. Very festive, isn't it? Second part, which in terms of the counting on this slide is actually a third part. How do we get it done? So we've done why, or at least I hinted at why, and hopefully you can now tell me some of the reasons why yourself. I've given you some examples of what it can be done, what it can do, and now let's talk about how it can be done. And there will be program code, and you need a program code, of course, for the last section, which is the do-it-yourself section. So the Hello World of Playwright demos. This is Node.js code, and I hope you recognize it. I require the Playwright library, and more specifically, I require the Chromium object from the Playwright library. That's just one of three browser types that's available. The others are WebKit and Firefox. And I create a function, and in this function, I create a new browser instance. The Chromium browser, I launch it. I launch it in headless mode, which means I won't see the browser. It's there in the background. It's completely functional. But as an end user, I don't get to see it. So this is something that could easily run in a Docker container that doesn't expose a graphical interface. And almost all operations, or probably all operations through Playwright, are asynchronous. And that's why there's always the await statement. That's the easiest way in Node to do a sequential form of asynchronous interactions, or basically we make asynchronous synchronous a little. So that's the await. And when this statement is done, the browser constant contains a reference to the browser that has been launched. And in this browser, I can now create a browser context, or I can create a browser page, which is the same thing as a tab. And then I can dictate that this page should be loaded with whatever's available at this URL. But it's not too hard. This is functionally the same thing as typing the URL into the location bar of the browser and pressing enter. It all happens in the background because we're running in a headless mode. And here I can take, or this statement takes a screenshot. So whatever is showing up at this URL when the navigation is complete is now written to an image file on the local file system, a PNG file. And I close the browser. I'm not running any tests. I'm not doing any interaction. I'm not inspecting the DOM. This is about as simple as it can get. I do something, I go to a site, I load a site into my embedded browser, and I take a screenshot. Most programs using Playwright will start with creating a browser instance, creating a page, and navigating the page. It could navigate to any URL, any URL that's accessible from the system on which the program is running. in this case my laptop, any application my laptop can access, I can access in this program. Sometimes I may need to provide additional authentication details, of course. And that's something that I can do as a step, as a manual step in an automated process when I run in head full mode. I could maybe do it by preloading cookies and local storage that may contain the authentication information. Or I can do it programmatically by setting HTTP headers at browser level. The Playwright resources that you will need when you start developing. I already showed you the homepage. On the homepage, you will find the API documentation, which looks very good and is quite extensive. Really well done. And there's this site, the headless.dev, that also contains articles about many interesting features of Playwright and the code that you need to make use of these features. The headless.dev is not specifically for Playwright, it also describes Puppeteer, and you will see that there are many similarities between Puppeteer and Playwright, but you also see now that Playwright is accelerating in its evolution and goes beyond Puppeteer. So before I showed you the API that I had created on top of the Google Translate UI, and what I needed to do for this, of course, I need the URL for the Google Translate web UI. And I also need to understand this web UI page. What are the elements in the page? And specifically, what's the element that contains the source text? Well, this element turns out to be the only text area element in the page, which makes it fairly easy to access in my code. I just go and look up the text area element. And then the UI automatically provides the translation from the source language into the target language. When the text has been typed or pasted into this text area, after a few hundred milliseconds, the translation appears. Well, this particular element that contains the translation I'm interested in can be selected using a CSS selector, which basically means look for an element which has the class VL, well, this is the class identifier, which is not a very intuitive one. And underneath this element, get me the first span element, and underneath this span element, get me its first span child. That turns out to be the element that contains the translation. And here you can see certain brittleness and a certain not so intuitiveness, which is unfortunate, and perhaps there's a better way of doing it, but I haven't found it yet for Google Translate. So in code, what's happening? Well, the start of the code is the same as you saw before, but now you see my function has three additional parameters: the source text, source language, and the target language. I create a browser, I create a browser context, and in the browser context, I create a page. Nothing Google specific so far. I navigate to the URL for Google Translate, and it turns out that source language and target language can pass in the URL as query parameters. So that's not something that I need to manipulate through the DOM or through the JavaScript context. It's something I can pass in the URL. That's easier in this particular case. Once the navigation has started, I make Playwright wait for the selector text area to be resolved. So once there is an element that can be selected using this selector, my code will continue. That's when the source text element is available. Then I type the source text into the text area, into this element that's found using the selector. I don't actually type it, I fill it. There's also an option to type, and when you use type, then the browser will have the idea that the user is actually typing, and you can even slow down the typing so that it feels like the keys are really pressed one by one with a few hundred milliseconds in between. at this stage, and I'm not sure this is the shortest waiting time, but I will wait for 800 milliseconds to give Google Translate the opportunity to take the contents in the text area and provide the translation in the translation area. My next step is to use this expression, page dot dollar dollar eval, get me all elements returned by this selector. It turns out that the translation is not just one single text block, but is provided in multiple lines or multiple span elements. So this expression returns all the spans, and this collection of span elements is used here as an input parameter for another piece of JavaScript, this piece of JavaScript. Here, with the map function, I iterate through all the span elements, and from each span element, I take the inner text, which is basically the text content. I then take all these text elements together, basically concatenate them into one single string, and that string is translation. And finally, I return the translation as a result from this function. So for anyone invoking the function, it feels like, well, it doesn't just feel like, they provide source text, source language, and target language, and get in return a string which contains a translation of whatever source text they provided. The fact that in order to produce that result, the code needed to run a browser, load Google Translate, manipulate Google Translate, and get some information from the Google Translate UI, that's all, of course, encapsulated, as it should be. I mentioned the selector, and anyone using CSS, anyone building web applications, will be familiar with selectors. In order to interact with the elements in a web application, with forms, with fields, with buttons, and these interactions could be of a very specific type. The three main types of selectors that Playwright supports. First of all, text. And that's the easiest one and the most intuitive one. It's the one that we users also use. So there is a button which has a text that's login. We will click on a button which says login. And here I make Playwright click on a button with the text login. Well, actually, I don't specify here that it should be a button. So in this case, Playwright could be trying to click on an object that's not a button, but that still contains the text login. By the way, it doesn't need to have login as a text itself. It could also have a child element that has this text in it, or a child of a child element. So if we see a certain text on an element, even if that text has been defined three levels down, Playwright will also recognize that element, which is really quite powerful. These text selectors have been added in only a very recent release of Playwright, by the way. Second type of selector is the CSS selector. That's the traditional one. That's where we use the types of the element, like span, or A, or body, or IMG, a dot, and a class name, a CSS class name. These can be defined on the elements in a web application using the class property. With the angle bracket, we indicate that taking the element we find using this selector, we want to go to a child element of type button in this case. And of course, this type button could also be restricted by another dot, and then another class name. And it could also be restricted by square brackets and a selection on an attribute. Third type of selector is the XPath selector, which uses XPath queries and considers the the DOM as an XHTML or an XML document and returns information in that way. Selectors, peers, as they call it in the documentation, the shadow DOMs that we can use with web components. This is not my area of expertise, so I'm hoping, I hope I'm using the right terminology here. The selectors do not go into iframes. If you want to find an element in an iframe, you need to look yourself into that iframe. The page object has a property which is a collection called frames, and you can iterate through these frames. Selectors can return multiple elements. If they do, either you process all the elements yourself, and if you don't, then any operation that you define on the result of a selector will act only on the first element returned by that selector, and all the other elements are ignored. It's something you will find out when you start working with Playwright. Well, to locate a DOM element, we know we need to use selectors. We can help ourselves as developers by using the browser, by loading the application or the site we're interested in a browser, using Ctrl-Shift-I to open the browser developers, the browser developer tools. I'm sure most of you probably have seen them. We can look for the elements, and we can also use the console, and in the console, try out selectors with the $parenthesis quote, and then type our selector, end quote, end parenthesis, and check whether the selector returns anything. Not all selectors that Playwright can handle can be tried out this way, by the way. So in Playwright, we can do more than the console supports. But the console still, of course, is extremely helpful to understand the structure of a website or a web page. Now, this is one thing that threw me for quite some time. You have to be aware of the fact that when using Playwright from a Node.js application, you really are dealing with two different JavaScript contexts. There's the JavaScript context in Node.js itself, and in this context, well, you have full access to the file system. You have access to any NPM module you like. You can interact over the network. You can interact with the database. You can do anything you can do in a Node application, because that's what it is. It's a Node application, and it's its JavaScript context. And then when you use Playwright, you also bring a browser into existence. And inside this browser, there's also a JavaScript context. And this JavaScript has full access to the DOM. It has access, of course, to its own context. It can use web APIs. It can make network calls from within the browser. It can use the browser session's authentication status, which can be very powerful. You can manipulate the DOM, add, change, remove elements. You can handle events, publish events. You can invoke JavaScript functions inside the browser. But it's a separate context. And it took me a while to realize. In both contexts, for example, you can use console.log. In the Node.js context, it will write whatever you send to console.log to your command line. When you run console.log in the browser context, you will send it to the browser console, and you will be able to see it in the Ctrl-Shift plus I developer tools console that's running inside the browser. Two different areas. They are similar. The code that you write is similar, but they are separate. So it's important that you realize. Then Playwright provides a bridge between the two contexts. So you can access JavaScript inside the browser context from your Node.js environment, from the JavaScript application that you write in Node. You can execute JavaScript in the browser context and then do all the things through that execution that in the browser context can be done. Vice versa, you can publish functions in your Node.js application, publish these functions on the window object in the browser context, so that inside the browser context, you can invoke a function that's actually a function in the Node.js application. I will show you some examples. So here, this is an example of adding a shortcut key to a web application. When I load the web application in my Playwright browser and I press Control and Y, I would then take a snapshot of the current page. And we know that Playwright provides functionality to take a snapshot, but of course that functionality is not automatically available inside a web application. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to create a function snapshotter in my Node application. And this function will invoke the screenshot function in Playwright that will create the PNG file. But how to invoke this function from the web application whenever the user in the web application presses Control and Y? Well, the next step in the solution is exposing the Node.js function on the window object inside the browser context. That's something that that Playwright allows us to do. So we can expose a Node.js function, we can expose it and make it available in the browser context. And then also through Playwright, we add additional JavaScript code to the web application. So after the page has loaded, we execute this statement that adds an event listener for the key up event that then will invoke a function called handle shortcut key. And we also need to add the function itself, the function handle shortcut key, to the web application. So after loading a page, we can inject additional JavaScript and also CSS definitions, by the way, into the page. And then this key event listener becomes active. And when the user presses Control plus Y, function handle shortcut key is invoked. That will invoke the snapshotter function property on the window object, which is a proxy for the function snapshotter, which will invoke the screenshot function on the Playwright page object that will create the screenshot. You load a web application in the embedded browser, you press Control plus Y, you get a screenshot. In this case, of course, the screenshot isn't all important. It's the mechanism of the two JavaScript contexts and the ability to bridge between the two. So here's the code. Here's the function that's called snapshotter. It's a function that gets the source object from Playwright and that then takes a screenshot and writes it to this file on the file system. Browser is launched, context is created, and in this context, I'm exposing a function. I'm exposing the function snapshotter. I'm exposing it on the window object inside the browser context. So it can be invoked from within the browser as window.snapshot function. I'm then also adding a JavaScript snippet into the page. So context.addInitScript, an initialization script, which is executed every time a page is loaded in the browser or refreshed. And this snippet is defined here. This is code that will be executed in the browser context. So even though it has been defined in the Node.js application, it's brought over, injected into the browser context. And that's the key up event listener. And then I create a page. I navigate a page to a certain URL. And at that point, a page is loaded in the browser. It's visible to the user because headless is false. And this page contains all of a sudden an additional shortcut key combination. Control plus Y is now active, even though it wasn't added to the application or the website I've loaded into my browser. Here are some of the main ways of manipulating the web page that's loaded into the Playwright browser from within the Node application. As you just saw, we can add an initialization script. We can add a script tag, just like adding a script tag with contents to the page. But in this case, we are adding it programmatically. We can expose a Node.js function inside the browser context. We can also add CSS styles using page.addStyle tag. We can also execute a JavaScript snippet at any moment in the context of the web page. So in this case, I'm evaluating console.log name from Node.js. This section over here. This will result in a line being printed on the console inside the browser, obviously. And here I'm manipulating a DOM element in a very similar way. So I'm sending a CSS selector for an element. This selector will get me a DOM element. This DOM element is passed as an input parameter into the snippet, and the snippet will set the display property on the style attribute of this element to none, basically hiding this element. Think for the interest of time, I'll skip this for now. You saw already how I had added a toolbar into Wikipedia. This is just the same thing. So using the techniques from the previous slide, it's fairly easy to manipulate any web page that we load into the embedded browser and inject additional HTML, additional CSS, and additional JavaScript into the page. You can try this out in hands-on later on. This is a description of the implementation. Here's the code, but as I said, I think for now it's probably better to skip it. Some of the things that Playwright allows us to do in the browser context. So this is something we can do in our Node.js application by manipulating the browser context. We can read and write cookies. We can work with the persistent context that can be used in multi-factor authentication scenarios. We can interact with local storage, probably mentioned most of this. We can set the locale and the time zone, allowing us to fairly easily test our web applications for different time zones or different locations in the world, different regions. We can also set the geolocation that our browser will report to the web application. We can define the size of the viewport, the dimensions, and also we can specify that we are, well, we can pretend to run on a certain mobile device, so that allows us to perform testing of the web application as it would run on different screen sizes and different devices. We can define a user agent, we can interact with the web workers. We can, as I said before, modify, abort, and take over from HTTP requests, allowing us to perform a mock test. We can work with WebSockets. It's fairly advanced. And it's also easy to add a listener to the Playwright page object to listen to many types of events that can take place during the lifetime of a browser and our page inside the browser. And we can then respond to each of these events. And some of the events are listed here. Whenever something is written to the console inside the browser, we can trap that event and listen to whatever is written. When there's a dialogue opened, when there's a load completed from the network, when there's a file chooser being displayed, all these events can be intercepted and can be responded to. This, by the way, is already a fairly advanced area, of course. Okay. When we want to test the web application we create ourselves, we are masters of how testable the application is. if we don't think at all about testability, we might make life much harder for ourselves than it needs to be. And of course, this doesn't just apply to testing with Playwright, it also applies to testing with other tools. So if it's our application that we control, we probably would help ourselves by having fixed element identifiers, meaningful identifiers, meaningful CSS class names, fixed class names, implement, and I will show you in a moment what I mean by this, implement client-side logic in standalone JavaScript functions that do not interact with DOM and have interaction with DOM in a separate function. So we can also test this client-side logic apart from UI interaction. I will show you this in a moment. If there are functions in the web application that set a value on a DOM element, they would normally not return any value because, well, it returns value by setting the value on the DOM element. But when we want to test the function itself, it would be convenient if the function also returns the value it sets, so we can test the function, if you follow what I mean. When we are testing with Playwright, it's good to realize that the browser object, so for example, the Chromium object, that's a heavy object that uses quite some resources, especially memory resources. But any context and any page within those contexts that we create is fairly lightweight. So once we have a browser running, we can easily create multiple contexts and multiple pages or tabs within those contexts and run many tests at the same time, which we probably want to do in order to speed up the testing process and be able to automate a fairly large number of tests and run the tests all the time, as we want to do in software engineering. It might be very convenient to make use of prepared cookies, prepared local storage state, prepared persistent context, in order to run our tests from a certain starting point. I was working with an automation of the Oracle Cloud infrastructure console, and because I'm running with Playwright, I'm running in an anonymous browser, it kept asking me to accept cookies and also to prove that I wasn't a robot, whereas of course I was a robot. And then I realized that all these steps result in the number of cookies created in the browser context. And if those cookies are already present, then all these questions aren't asked. So instead of going through the motions of creating a Playwright script that had to answer all these cookie-related questions that were quite difficult to intercept because they were all part of iframes and nested iframes, etc., I can just go through all the steps once manually and then save the cookies that are created. And the next time I load the cookies at the start of my script, all these questions aren't asked anymore, and I can immediately proceed to the console that I wanted to run with. Of course, you can also initialize a context by running a JavaScript snippet in the browser context, for example, to set values on fields, start by making some AJAX calls so that at the beginning of our actual test, many things are already in place. While testing, you can take screenshots and you can make an MP4 movie. You probably want to remove it for all the tests that succeed. But for any test that fails, it's convenient to be able to manually inspect what went wrong, or at least it might be valuable. A Playwright element handle represents a DOM element, and you can inspect all the attributes and properties of the DOM element inside your Node.js application by using the element handle. I think I have an example of that later on. And it might be useful to perform a test by collecting many results from a certain page, collect all these findings in a single object, and then take the object with all these findings and run evaluations and assertions in one go, instead of having a simple assert for everything you want to test immediately in the Playwright browser context, because that can make your tests fairly heavy. If for every single field that you want to inspect, you have to restart the browser context, not necessarily the browser context, but page context, load page, initialize the page. It's not always the case that you would have to resort to this, but it's certainly something to consider. So a very simple example of how you can enhance testability. This is an example I took from a web page. Two fields, a number can be entered in each field, and then a button can be pressed to, in this case, calculate the multiplication. Here's the definition of the HTML. The fields each have a fairly clear identifier, and when the button is clicked, a JavaScript function is invoked. Now the function is shown here, and in this case, the function does two things. It interacts with the DOM, so it gets the elements and it sets the value of the result element, the result span. It also performs the business logic. And even though the business logic in this case is fairly simple, I think it still shouldn't be mixed. So in order to test both the UI as well as the business logic, I would suggest that this should be implemented in this way. So there's the original function that does the DOM interaction, but that invokes a separate function for the business logic. And again, granted, the business logic is extremely simple here, but it could also be fairly complex. So I want to be able, in my test, to test both the UI interaction, fill these two fields, click on multiply, and check the contents of the span. That's what I want to check. That's basically the functionality in this function, but I can't test the function because it doesn't have an input or a result. And I also want to test this function that has the business logic. So by splitting up this function, I can test more of the logic in my application. That's basically what I'm saying here. So what it would look like in Playwright terms, first I'm testing the UI interaction. So I'm filling the element returned by this selector. I'm filling it with the X. I'm taking the second one, filling it with the Y. I'm clicking on the element identified by multiply. This would give me this button because that has the label multiply. And then the UI result that I get into my Node application is taken by evaluating the selector hash result, which is a span. And from this span, reading the inner text, that value is returned, and here the value is printed, and it should be 42. And we can see it's 42, and here Playwright can also see it's 42. Then I also want to test the business function, and here's this test. So the result of invoking the business function is the outcome of the page.evaluate, which invokes inside the browser context this JavaScript function multiply. It's passing in the X and the Y. These X and Y are passed in as input parameters. This is a little bit cryptic if you're not very deep into JavaScript, by the way. And the values of the X and the Y are passed in as the X and the Y that are defined up here. And finally, the result from the test of the business logic function is also printed. And in this case, both will return 42, which they should. But now by splitting the original function into a pure business logic and a function that interacts with the DOM, I can test both. At this stage, I'm going to invite you to try this out yourself. And of course, you can do so right now, and you can do so later on. The resources that you need are at this URL, bit.ly/Playwright PW-14Jan, that's today. And what's in this workshop? If you go to the URL, you will go to GitHub, and in GitHub you will go into this document, And this document gives you all the instructions. All the sources are part of the same GitHub repository, and also the slides are part of this GitHub repository. And you will find three parts: the installation, the running, where you can just try out the demonstrations I was showing you, and you can inspect the code and make changes to the code and see what these changes result in. And then, of course, you can do it yourself. And I provide instructions for your own simple Hello World application. And at some point, of course, you have to start trying it on your own. Installation, basically two scenarios. The first one will work in any environment where you have a Node.js runtime and an NPM installed. And once you have those installed, and you probably have them already on your laptop, you can easily install Playwright. It's a simple NPM instruction. And then you can clone the repository with all the resources for this meetup and start doing the workshop. All these instructions, again, are available from this URL. Alternatively, if you are on Windows and you are on Windows 10 and you have the Windows Sandbox option enabled, then this article provides, and also the workshop document, by the way, provides instructions for you for creating a sandbox with the entire workshop environment. That's a very clean environment, and that might be an easier way of doing a workshop. But of course, it requires you to be on Windows 10 and you have to enable the sandbox option. As I said, the second part of the do-it-yourself section is going through the demos. Most of these demos I've shown you already. I haven't shown you the quick steps. They are self-explanatory and they are introduced in the workshop document. And finally, do it yourself. I've provided instructions and the code snippets that you can compile together for creating, well, a fresh Node.js application, copying and pasting code to create a Playwright browser and a page and to load a website in that browser page. And then to extend from there to interact with the website. The website is initially Wikipedia. To click, to scroll, to scrape some information, then to execute JavaScript in the browser, to replace content in the DOM, just as an example of how you can do so through Playwright from your own Node.js application. And then to open a second website in a second browser tab, to search in this website, and to perform some very basic tests. And I think with this, you have probably a pretty good starting point for doing it and going it alone, starting to use Playwright for your own scenarios. At least that's what I'm hoping for. That was a lot of talk, a lot of information, and I guess we are already close to the indicated end time. I hope this was useful. If you have any feedback for me, either tell me right away or leave a note in the chat or reach out to me afterwards. If you have questions or want to have some discussion, I will be around for a little bit longer. If you have questions regarding the workshop, let me know as well. So at this stage, let's open up the mics. Of course, you're free to leave as well, but if you have any feedback, please share it with me. I really like to know what you think of the story and what your next steps are going to be. That became very quiet.
Lucas, can you hear me? Can you hear
me? Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I had to be away for some time, and then maybe you answered my question. If so, please tell me, and then...
That's okay. Go ahead.
It was a question about... you said at some point that you can demo whatever you do in Playwright, and then you can
show it to your clients or to whomever, your friends, your whatever, what you made, what you created in Playwright. But can you share that in the sense that people can start something, run something without me showing them, like a standalone something?
You can, but it requires them to be able to run a Node.js application. So they would need a Node runtime environment. And that, of course, probably requires a little bit of technical proficiency, or a lot of trust, because you could create a script that it first installs Node.js and then installs your own sources and Playwright. The cleanest way of doing so would be through a Windows sandbox if they are on a sandbox environment, or, but this is an area I'm not an expert in, you probably could run a head full scenario in a Docker container and expose a graphical connector that allows you to, well, still make it visible outside a container, but I'm not sure that can be done or how it can be done. So
yes, and this is quite technical. I was actually more interested in being able to show it to people who have nothing to do with technique.
Yeah, I understand.
But can I export a video of?
Yeah, you can.
So basically, I can create a Playwright thing, run it, record as a video, and then give them the video.
Yeah, absolutely. And actually, that's the third example in the workshop.
To create a video. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. It's a single line command. It's really very simple. You're welcome. You're welcome. Anyone else? Questions? Did you like it? Do you have a plan of using it yourself? Anything?
Yes, I like to use it. For example, for today, I came into an example. For example, to say, okay, when I need to download the newest version of Chrome, for example, from the download page, it's always the first link on the page. I can automate that. I assume.
Yeah, of course you can. Yeah.
And those kind of things that might be interesting to use. One of the questions that I still have is, for example, if you use that example you used for your timesheet, for example, do you have can you also have checks in there? Or it's of course your own application then. Because if you add one line of an extra project where you have to write your hours on, your automation might break by doing that.
So again, that's fairly brittle. And since this is a script I've created for myself, and actually I'm using it every day, so it's really making my life more comfortable, that doesn't help anyone else. If I were to share that script with someone who's not technical, it probably wouldn't benefit them for long. So that's certainly a limitation, but you can't have it all.
No, okay. Yeah. It sounds very good. Thank you very much for presenting it. And I think it cost you a lot of time to create it. So thank you very much for all the time that you put into that. Yeah.
You're welcome. Thank you for acknowledging it.
Lucas, tell me one thing. These have some kind of integrations with the desktop applications. My question is because there are some websites where we need to authenticate using client certificates, and in Chrome the pop-up that appears is a desktop pop-up, is not a web pop-up. How we can handle with this?
I don't know. But since you're running a Node.js application locally on, for example, your laptop, anything you can do from within the Node.js application or from within a script that you can start from the application, a command line script, could help you. So I know there's a tool called AutoHotkey that allows you to create automation scenarios on Windows. Perhaps you could have an AutoHotkey script invoked from your Node application that performs all the desktop side actions that need to be performed, that then subsequently would allow your Node application to continue with your Playwright interaction. But this is just guessing.
I can imagine that if I would write a website, that I would not be too happy with the possibility that my website would be used by users from Playwright. Is it possible to prevent the usage of these kind of tools?
Certain aspects of the usage of the tools I found out. For example, the Spotify site. The web player for Spotify has been protected against the injection of scripts and against the injection of style snippets, I think. So a certain level of protection is possible as long as whatever Playwright does is exactly the same thing as what a user could do. There really isn't a protection possible, I think, and then there shouldn't be a protection, because if you're really just acting like a user but you're having a program acting on your behalf, then I don't think that a protection is necessary or justified. But against specific programmatic manipulation and injection, certain protections are available. I also try to replace an image in one website, I don't remember which one, but I couldn't pull that off because there also was a protection against loading an image from a different source than the list of supported or allowed sources for images. Trying to think of which one it was. Even creating an image from a Base64 encoding of an image didn't work, because it was identified as being the wrong source. So, long story short, some protection is possible, but not to regular usage of a website or web application.